an amazing pastor. And I, at times, call her pastor because I refer to her as pastor. She pastors me at times, so it's sometimes she corrects me, which is good. That's good. Say amen. I don't want a friend that's just going to go along with me. I want a friend that's going to help me to grow. And, you know, the thing that attracted me to Pastor Lori is that she's just, again, full of wisdom. And through the years, I feel like I have grown so much, you know, by her wisdom. She knows the word. And I want to hang around with somebody that knows more than I do. Amen. And I think that's important, is that, you know, we pick people that are going to help us to get to where we want to go. And I believe that Pastor Lori is one of those people. But how many of you guys are excited that, you know, today God gave you another opportunity to live? You know, I thank God. I don't, you know, there was a time that I took life as it came. And those days were very damaging because I made lots of mistakes in those years. I just kind of, you know, got up and lived my life, you know, just very unwise. I was a fool. And as I've come to the Lord through the years, I've learned more and more as I've gotten older. And I hope that you can get a hold of this. And what I'm going to say is we need to look at life on a daily basis and live in expectation. We need to. You know, we have to live in expectation. And today I'm going to talk to you about faith. And to me, it's such a vital key component, a vital component that I've had to live by all of my walk with God. And that's a true story. Because Pastor Nathi and I, for those of you that don't know me, we started off, we had very, very humble beginnings. And it's not because we didn't have, because we both came from families that were very, you know, that were upper middle class, if you say. His father owned a construction company. When he was the only son, Prashanathi was one boy out of four girls, so he was very spoiled, and he ended up getting himself in a lot of trouble. So his father had to hire attorneys and buy him car after car because he was foolish. He'd get a car and he'd wreck it and whatever. And you know, his father and mother weren't serving God, so they did their best. And I come from a family that my mother is the only child from a second marriage. My grandmother came from Mexico when she was 11 years old in 19, I believe, 11 or maybe a little around 14. Because she was born in 1905. You guys do the math. As you can see, I'm not very good at that. But nevertheless, so she came, and her mother had a dream of freedom, but her mother was very ill. So she lived, when she came here to the United States or to California, she literally had to go from door to door and ask for help because they had nothing, because her mother was sick. And so she went begging from door to door. But she got a concept. She got a revelation at a young girl, how would it look like to work hard. And she began to work hard, and by the time my grandmother died, she owned multiple properties. She taught her children how to work hard, and they all own businesses. My family, you know, they're doing okay. But my mother was the second, from a second marriage, so she was, her siblings' children were, she grew up with them. And my grandmother had worked so hard, so by the time my mom was born, she was raised in a Catholic school and you know, private education and all that kind of stuff. So when my mom married my father, my father's a good man, but when she married him, she went for looks because he literally was tall, dark, and handsome, really. So she was deceived by his looks. And I mean, he's a good man. He loves the Lord now, but they had a very difficult time. So my mother and my father divorced or separated when I was about 5 or 6 years old. And my mother didn't want to tell my grandmother. I'm just kind of giving you some key points because you'll understand where, if we don't understand or take time to listen to where people come from, then it's easy to judge them. It's easy to misunderstand people. You know, I'm a very strong woman because I had to learn to be strong. I had to fight my way through life, literally. So anyway, my mother and my father divorced. My mother did not want to tell her mother, which had finances, that she needed help. So we literally lived on beans and rice because my mom didn't want to say she needed help. My mom started working two jobs, so we were those, what are they called, latchkey kids. And my mom would leave early. Our neighbor would come and make sure that we were dressed. We'd go next door and have breakfast at our neighbor's. We'd walk to school alone, come home alone. We would go, you know, I was 7, 8 years old when we had that earthquake in the 70s. My brother and I were alone at home, that strong earthquake, if you guys remember. That scared the living daylights out of me. Too bad it didn't scare hell out of me, but, you know, I had to go through some things. But my point is this, you know, is there was a lot of, my father ended up leaving my mom and chased women and did all those kind of things. So I grew up very insecure, very, very insecure. You know, I was told here and there, people lied to me and said that, you know, I was an okay looking woman or a young girl at the time. And, but I was very insecure. My self-esteem was this big because I was rejected as a child. My father kicked me out of the house when I was 5 or 6 years old. I had gotten a bad report card, and he thought it was funny to pretend he called the police, and he told them to come and pick me up. He had me grab, in those days it was a brown paper bag. He proceeded to take me in the room, and he had me put some jammies and a few things in there, and then he had me go outside, and it was about, I want to say 8 o'clock at night. I'm not sure what time, but it was dark out, and we lived right across the street from the freeway, so you'd see the cars jumping on the freeway, and he had me sit out there and wait for the police to come and pick me up. And every time the lights would come down the road, I was scared to death that it was the police, because he said I wasn't good enough to live with them anymore because I got a bad report card at kindergarten or first grade. And you know what that bad report card was? It was, I talked too much. My teacher said I talked too much. So at a very young age, the devil tried to take my voice, is what he did. And I never understood these things. It took me years to get it. So I want to say this to you before I get started, is it's so important that we deal with the insecurities in our lives. So important. Because if we don't, we will live our lives in doubt and unbelief. We will believe that we are not good enough for the blessings that God has for us. And I'm telling you, there's over 7,000 promises in the Word of God. And even in my later years now that I've gone older, I have gotten so, I am just hungry and so passionate about growing. I have worked with Pastor Emmanuel and Pastor Toyin a few times. I've sat with them and I've had to humble myself because I never was a person that wanted to be corrected. And I didn't really want to hear what other people had to say, but I've come to a point in my life past few years ago. I mean, it's just been a long journey, but I had to get real with myself if I was going to fulfill what God had called me to do. And if you want to fulfill what God has called you to do, I encourage you to really trust your pastor here. You have some amazing pastors. And allow them to speak into your life. Allow them to bring correction. Allow them to open up to help you in your blind side. Because we all have blind sides. Those areas that we cannot see. God uses me for my husband to see those blind sides, those things that he cannot see. And even the hidden things that he cannot see. There was a man by the name of Blind Bartimaeus. I'm not going to talk about him today. But I will say this. He had to choose to throw off that beggar's coat. And maybe you're not a beggar. Obviously, you're not. But what coat do you have to take off? Do you have to take off a coat of insecurity? Do you have to take off a coat of rejection? A coat of unbelief? You've been walking with God for years, but you're unbelieving? No, we have to get a hold of what the Word of God says and be intentional and say, God, you said it in your Word, and it will. It shall come to pass in my life. So with everything that I've been through in my life, I'm telling you, with some of the things. I mean, there's so much more. Have you here for 3 days? But when I came to the Lord, I had to be intentional about believing God. What he said in his word was yes and amen. We have the opportunity to say yes to it. Our God says yes to his word, and then we have to be the ones that say amen. And God wants us. He's constantly waiting for us to say yes. Amen, Lord. I believe what you're saying is true. I believe that I'm not going to go down like this. I believe that you have so much better for my life. I believe that what you've called me to do, I will fulfill those things. Amen. It's so easy for us to bite in to the lies of the enemy. And those lies will tell us so much negative. And my question at the end of this sermon, I'll give it to you up front, is what are you believing? Are you believing the promises of God? Or are you believing the lies of the enemy? God gave me a revelation about fear, because fear is such a demonic spirit that will keep us back from moving forward in our lives. Fear that you'll never get married. Fear that you will never have children. Fear that you'll never come out of debt. Fear that you'll never get healed. Fear that your marriage won't turn around. What is it? Fear that you won't fulfill what God has called you to do. Because everything that you look at, that's in front of you, looks opposite to what God has promised you. But I'm telling you today, you're going to see in the word that we cannot go by what we hear the enemy say. Fear. He brings up, he wants to flood your minds with fear and unbelief. And God gave me a revelation. My friend has heard it many times, but I'm going to say it to you. Fear. F-E-A-R. And if you have, I want you to put that just one thing up there, if you could. Fear. Because I want you to see something. It's so important that we understand how the enemy comes. And once they do, you're going to notice that fear, how do you spell fear? If you drop the F, what do you have? So fear, I never seen that in my life. F-E-A-R. If we give an ear to fear, because fear will speak to us all day and all night. And we need to see that fear, if we give it an ear, come on somebody, then it's over. But we cannot operate in fear. We will not operate in fear. We will operate in faith. Come on. We're going to operate in faith, believing God that what he said that he's going to do, he will do. So I want to take us just real quick to two scriptures, and then I'm going to go into a quick story because I want to be done in time. I don't want to speak too long. And it's two very familiar scriptures in 2 Corinthians 4:17. I just want you to see this real quick, and then we're going to move forward. 2 Corinthians 4:17. Some of you know that scripture by heart. I'm sure your mom does. But I have to read it out of the Bible just so I am accurate. I got a new Bible. And for those of you that have never read this translation, it is amazing. I love it. It's the Passion Translation. So good. So good. So 4:17 says this. It says, we view our slight, short-lived troubles in the light of eternity. We see our difficulties as the substance that produces for us an eternal, weighty glory far beyond all comparison. Because we don't focus our attention on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but the unseen realm is eternal. And then the second scripture that I want you to look at is 2 Corinthians 5:7. We know this scripture. For we live by faith, not by what we see with our eyes. Come on, we live by faith and not what we see. And it's the simplest scripture in the Bible, but it's the hardest one to live by. Come on, because we know the word, and the Lord spoke to me some time ago, and he said, Teresa, don't be so familiar. Don't get so familiar with the word of God, because you know the word, You've heard the word, you've read the word, but you're not living the word, Teresa. You need to be a doer of the word and not just a hearer. Oh, I have faith. Oh, I have faith. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. But when we begin to look at our circumstances, we're tossed to and fro like the waves. We don't want to be tossed to and fro. We want to believe what the word of God says. When my husband, going back to my history, when I met Pastor Nathi, he was a drug addict. He used heroin for 15 years. He started using drugs when he was 12. By the time he was 15, he was addicted to heroin. He was they were pregnant with the baby. He had a daughter at 15 years old. I mean, his life was an absolute mess. So when I got to meet him, and he was when I met him, he was 24. This guy had no Jesus in him. He never even went to church. He didn't even know what a Catholic church looked like. At least I knew what a Catholic church looked like. And I thank God that I was raised in the Catholic church, because I had the fear of God. Not so much fear, because I continued to do what I did. But I knew of him. And I would go to the church by myself at 8 years old. And I would go and confess my sin to the priest. And I'd say 5 Hail Marys and 10 Our Fathers, depending on, I don't know if you guys know what I'm talking about. And I thank God for those, that foundation, because at least I knew God. Pastor Nathi didn't know him at all. So when I come to the things of God at 24 years old, I give my life to the Lord. I'm telling him, you're a man of God. You're going to work in the church and you're going to preach the word. He's telling me that I am crazy. And he didn't cuss at me, but he would say other things to me and were very discouraging. But because I did not live by the way that I see, what it's saying here is that we do not live by what we see. We cannot live by what we see or our emotions. And many times we're up and down like a roller coaster because we live by emotions. We cannot live by emotions. Every morning I have to talk myself into believing what the word of God says. You, Pastor Teresa, after all those years, yes, because the enemy comes at me harder because I know the word. And he's always trying to twist up what the word says. But I don't fall for his tricks because I know better. But because I have a relationship with God and it's ongoing, and every day I can't live by what I did yesterday. I have to get before the Lord today, and I spend time with the Lord, and because I do, I'm able to walk in faith. But even as a baby Christian, I couldn't go by, oh, I'm preaching the word to my husband or boyfriend because we were living together, but I'm still speaking the word. And then we got married, and then I got it right. But I would say, you know, you're going to get saved. You're going to serve the Lord. And I would, you know, share all these scriptures, Acts 16:31. I'd go through all these scriptures, and then I would tell them. And he'd go out today, I'm going to go look for a job. And he'd come home, and he'd be drunk or high. Well, my eyes are seeing one thing, but my faith is saying another. But I had to convince myself that I wasn't going to be moved by what I seen, but I was going to be moved that God was going to be faithful to his word. And that's what we need to do. I'm telling you, God wants to fill this church. He wants to fill your lives. God wants to do a great work, but you need to begin to believe God. You need to begin to believe God. Me and Pastor Nathi, God has opened up so many doors. I mean, I'm telling you, this guy came from a lot, but the doors that God is opening in this city are crazy. I was just telling your pastor that we got another grant, and I don't know, even know how much, $95,000, I have no idea. Now, we're not talking about the church, we're talking about his nonprofit. I'm believing God for that money to come into the church, but because we live by faith in our church. We work with inner city Santa Ana people that don't have a whole lot. But we walk by faith and we believe God. And so God's opened up so many doors for us. But the thing that I constantly am telling my husband is, don't get caught up in what God is doing, that you stop seeking God for the church, because your first call is to be a pastor. That's number one for you. And you can only take people as far as you are. And I'm always reminding him, I said, babe, thank God for what God is doing out there in the streets, and that we've believed God. He believed God from the time that he got saved and went into a men's home. He finally did go into a men's home for a year. And the pastor asked him, what do you want to do? He said, I want to work with young people. I want to work in the city. I want to win Santa Ana for Christ, because he was a terror in Santa Ana. He wanted to go back and he wanted to sow into his city where he was used to destroy. God said, he wanted God to send him back to rebuild. And God has sent us back. But now we have not, we're believing God, Pastor Lori and I, for one grant, and then we believe God for another grant. Now we're at 3 grants, and it's so much now, and it's all good, but I'm saying, we are not chasing money. We're not chasing any kind of a pat on the back. We're chasing Jesus. And if we don't have a plan in our life, if we are not believing God, if we don't have a plan, how many people do you want to see saved this year, babe? How many people do you want to see come to Christ, babe? Those are the things that we need to believe God for. If God called you to rebuild your city, then how many are you going to lead to Jesus and bring them into the church? Because it's not about going to other churches, bringing people from other churches, is about us going out there and bringing in the lost to the church. And that's what we need to do. Well, you don't have the highways and the byways like we do in Santa Ana, because you'll find them everywhere. But there's people at your workplace, there's your friends, there's people that you should have. Next Sunday, I encourage each and every one of you to bring one person with you to church and begin to be that faith, that hope that they need, because everybody needs hope. Everybody is believing for something. So why don't we ask, hey friend, you know what, you're on my heart and I've just been thinking about you. What are you going through? Because I'm praying for you. But not just say it, really pray for them. And I tell you, as you pray for them, God is going to begin to download some things so you can begin to help them. See, people want to blame the pastors for why the church is not growing. I'm telling you, we need to begin to see that it's really us. We tell our people all the time, you need to bring in people. We're doing our job. We're seeking God. We're praying. We're doing our job. And we make sure of that in Jesus' name. But we, as a church, need to come together and have vision with each other and say, you know what? I'm going to begin to make a difference. You know, we're going from 6 p.m. service to we're getting rid of the 6 p.m. or 5 p.m. service that we've had for 14 months. And we tried it. And it's okay. We tried it and it didn't work. It's okay. I don't feel bad. At least I tried. There's many people that don't even try, but at least I tried. So now we're going to go to 9 and 11. But what we're going to do with the people is say, you know what, we're dividing the church. Half of you guys are going to own 9 o'clock, and the other half of our main leaders are going to own the other, the 11 o'clock. And you guys are going to believe God together as a team to bring people, to invite people. And you guys are going to do the same thing. And we're coming together as a team. So I want to tell you guys, have some amazing pastors. And I'm sure I'm still trying to get to the story, but you guys have some amazing pastors. And there is wealth here. I want to tell you, worship team, I so sense the presence of God as you guys were worshiping. You know, you have everything that you need here. And I believe that God is just, he's up to something good. I tell Pastor Laura the other day, I said, I don't know what it is, but I feel something in the inside of my spirit. I don't know what it is, but I'm expecting God to do something great. I don't know what it is, but I can feel it in my bones. And if we look at 1 Kings 18, 41 through 46, and it's about Elijah, right? Did I get the last part right? Elijah. Okay. And what happened here? There was a drought in the land. You know, and I'm going to read it real quick. And I want to get to this because if not, I'll just tell you guys a bunch of stories. But you know what? I share the stories to encourage your faith. If God could use two people that were so lost out there in the world and had nothing. You know, yes, we came from good families, but God stripped us of everything. He stripped us of everything to a place when we came to the Lord where all we could do was believe God on welfare, believing God, but we were faithful tithers and we were faithful givers. And I got a revelation. There was a time that we'd only get $900 a month. That's what we lived on. $900 a month and that fed 6 people, put a roof over our head and paid the bills. $900, who could live like that? But I gave my $90 every single week or time we got our check. Pastor Nathi was going to college at that time. You know, it wasn't like he was just sitting there. We used it as a stepping stone, welfare, government cheese, powdered milk. I know you guys don't know what that looks like, I'm telling you. But my son is 6'2" and a half or 3, and he used to, you know, he was okay. We were eating, you know. But I believed God, but I got a hold of giving and tithing. And you know what I got a hold of is like, I want to believe God that I begin to make $3,000. I mean, it increased through the years. And even though I wasn't making $3,000 a month, I was giving a tithe as though I was. And I began to have a vision of how I wanted to see things. And I'm telling you, God has blessed our lives. We are not those people that came. You wouldn't think that we were the ones that came from Santa Ana the way that we did. And not that we think that we're better. God gave us an opportunity to see him shine, his light shine upon us, so we could tell other people on how good God is. If you do the word of God, you're going to see results. You're going to see results. I'm just a walking testimony. And again, there's so many to share. So I want to read this. Then Elijah said to Ahab, they were in a drought. And some of you guys are in a drought right now. Some of the places in your life, there's drought. You're not seeing rain. There's nothing. There's no sign of rain. There's no sign of life. Okay. And Elijah said to Ahab, go get something to eat and drink, for I hear a mighty rainstorm coming. What is it that you're hearing? Oh, I'm going to go there in a minute. Let me read this. So Ahab went to eat and to drink, but Elijah climbed to the top of Mount Carmel and bowed low to the ground and prayed. Say prayed. And he prayed with his face between his knees. And we heard Pastor Lori and I went to a meeting. And what that is like a woman in labor, how she has, you know, she's her legs are in the stirrup. And I'm not trying to get graphic here, but she has to believe God. She has to push the baby out. And that's what it is. When we pray, we need to push that breakthrough out. We need to be committed and push those dreams out. We got to push those things that God gave you. He gave you prophecy. He's given you a word. You got to begin to push it out. You got to begin to proclaim it. You got to begin to declare what it is that God is saying, not what you see. Amen. Are you with me? Okay. God, let's see. So then he said to his servant, this is 43, go and look out toward the sea. The servant went and looked. Then he returned to Elisha and said, I didn't see anything. Seven times Elijah told him to go and look. Finally, the seventh time, his servant told him, I saw a cloud, a little cloud about the size of a man's hand, rising from the sea. Then Elijah shouted, hurry to Ahab and tell him, climb into your chariot and go back home. If you don't hurry, the rain will stop you. Okay. And then, and soon the sky was black with clouds. A heavy wind brought a terrific rainstorm. Listen to this. And Ahab left quickly for Jezreel. Then the Lord gave special strength to Elijah. He tucked his cloak into his belt and he ran ahead of Ahab's chariot all the way to the entrance. I'm telling you, he got a revelation. He heard from heaven and he got a revelation and he beat out his servant. He ran ahead of him. You know why he did that? Because he ran with expectation. And I'm telling you, if you're not running, if you're not walking this walk out with Christ with some expectation, if you're just settling at that place, wherever it is that you're at right now, then I don't know what to say. Honestly, I don't want to be rude. There's been many times in my life that I've stood still thinking I'm believing God, but it was a cop out because I wasn't willing to believe God for what he had told me. Many times we say, oh, we're waiting on God. No, we need faith is walking. Faith is action. Faith is stepping out and believing God. Faith is declaring, you know what? I'm believing God for, you know, I don't know. Whatever it is, increase at your job. For us as pastors, Pastor Nathan and I, we're believing God for God to bring in a harvest. So we're putting it out there. We're putting a demand. We're challenging the people. That's what we're doing. I can only speak for ourselves.
But what is it that you're believing God for? Because if we have no vision, then we're not going to go anywhere. Oh, yeah, we're men of faith. We're women of faith. I'm a woman of faith. Pastor Nathie's a man of faith. But for a while there, all I seen him doing was believing God for what was out there. And I would tell your pastor, I would get so grieved in my spirit because it's sometimes easier to believe God for the outward things than to believe God for the things of God sometimes. Because there's such a struggle. The enemy wants to, he's playing tug of war. But I'm telling you, at the end of the story, we win. We just have to step out in faith and believe God. And, you know, so behind some of the things that we're going through, I just want to finish with this regarding Pastor Nathie and I, is we just came back from New York. And there was such a stagnant, we were kind of stagnant in some of the things that we were seeing in our lives. And I made sure that it was okay with Pastor Nathie that I shared this. And I want to say this because it's so important. It's so easy for us to get distracted. That's what I mean, not stagnant, distracted. And so we ended up going to New York and we sat under this pastor's meeting and it was amazing. It was incredible. The presence of God was there. But what blessed me the most is that Pastor Nathie came back with the fire. He's getting up again at 5 o'clock in the morning and seeking God like never before. When he preaches, I could feel the presence of God just coming in, not just through the worship, but when he speaks. And you know what? It's so easy for us in our lives, whether it be in our as pastors or in our marriages or whatever, where we just get distracted. And we need to just, today I just want to tell you guys, I want to encourage you to get back on track, to begin to see God. This is what Elijah did, is that he saw God. And I'm telling you, what are you, you know, he saw God. And the heavens begin to speak to him. God began to speak to him and say, even though you can't see it, you're in the desert or it's, you know, there's no rain. But I'm telling you, Elijah, just keep on seeking me and it's coming. And, you know, he began to hear the sound of rain. And my question to you is, what are you hearing? Whatever it is that God has spoken to you, begin to walk that out. Begin to speak it out. Begin to live it out. Don't, let's not just be people that, oh yeah, I walk by faith. And, you know, Romans 8:28, all things work together for the good, for those that love God. No, we don't want to just confess scripture. We want to be people that live by the scripture. That we know that when people see our life, they can see that there is something different in us. I don't care about the multitudes of people as much as I do in my church, the anointing of God. Because we live, it doesn't matter, Santa Ana or you know, Irvine, every single one of us, every single one of them out there need Jesus. They need a breakthrough. They may not look like the people in Santa Ana, but they're still broken, hurting. They've been rejected. They've been beat. Only God knows what they've been. Everybody needs Christ. And if people didn't need Christ and Jesus didn't have to go, I mean, even if it was for one person, then his dying on the cross was in vain. But everybody needs Jesus. And I tell my husband, babe, we need the power of God like I feel in this place. I feel the presence of God in this place. There's life in this place. And let's believe God that you are going to begin to see, begin to put a demand on the Spirit of the living God. Let's begin to put a demand on the Holy Ghost. Let's begin to cry out to God like never before. Let's begin to see God in our spirit man, in our mind's eye, do the things that God said he's going to do. Amen. So we need to serve God with our whole heart. So I want to give you just a couple of points. See, Elijah recognized the miracle when it was just in its beginning stage. I see that you guys are just in your beginning stage. Come on. This is not what God has so much more for you in your lives. I'm not talking about a church because we are the church. You and I are the church, not these curtains here. We are the church. So he recognized a miracle in its beginning stage. He didn't look at the abundance that was needed. He looked at a miracle working God. And so many times we look at what we need and our need is greater than our God. We don't want God to be less than, our need is not greater than God. Our God is greater than our need. Amen. It didn't look like the abundance he was believing God for. He was just in the beginning stages, but he recognized it. He heard from heaven. When he was on his knees, he could hear God saying, I'm not done with you. It's not going to end here. I have so much more in store for you. I have so much more in store for Ignite Church. I'm doing a new thing in this place. Let go of the past. Walk past the past. Let's begin to believe God for your future. You know, seven times, you know, when he would send his servant seven times, you know, he could have been discouraged and said at the fifth time, I'm done. Don't go out no more. He could have got stuck in his unbelief. And my question to you, has unbelief gripped your heart? Because you've gone five times already and you've seen nothing. Or you've gone three times. Or you've gone 30 years. Or you've gone 15 years. Has unbelief gripped your heart? And if it has, it's time for you to get that belief back in Christ. It says, we need to believe God. Those that walk out in faith please the Lord, right? What does the Bible say? That we need to walk out. Say it with me, guys. What's the scripture? No. That faith pleases God. There it is. Sorry, guys. Without faith, it's impossible. Say impossible. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. So some of the things that I wrote down, faith recognizes the impossible is possible. Faith recognizes that the impossible is possible. God is not done with you yet, Greg. God is doing something new in your life, Greg. God has so much for you. And if you just begin to cry out to God like never before, he's going to use you to bring in the glory of God. And people are going to come running from the north, the south, the east, and the west to come because they know that that's a hub. Ignite Church is a hub of the Holy Ghost. It's a place where miracles, signs, and wonders follow the word of God. God. I believe that. I believe it. I said, babe, we need to cry out to God in such a way. I am so hungry for God. I am so desperate for God. I have not seen my best days. And although God has done so many amazing things, I tell you, I'd have you here for 3 days. Just that God spoke to me one day. I was getting in the car from Stater Brothers, and he said, Teresa, you're going to have money coming in from so many avenues that no matter what it is that you want, you're going to be able to buy. That was several years ago, and do you know that I'm beginning to see that now? I tell my kids, they'll say, oh, Mom, Baba, I said, you know what? I worked my butt off believing God. Now it's time for you guys to walk in faith. And my daughter just got blessed just the other day. We believed God, and she just got over a $20,000 raise a year just from one day to the next. And I have been speaking life into my daughter because if anybody has gone through hell and with my family, it's this girl right here. Because I was so lost and so broken in the world that she's the one that took the brunt of my crazy life. And I do my best now to speak so much life. I was thinking about her today and I said, she's going to be my armor bearer. She's going to begin to travel with me. I'm going to begin to take her, not my Bree, because Bree already knows God, but I want to use this one because God has such a testimony in her that her and I are going to preach the word of God together on the pulpit and people are going to be set free because you don't know her testimony, but I know her testimony and you don't really know my testimony, but God knows my testimony. And together, we're going to break the chains off of people that are so bound up. See, that's faith. And I used to tell Pastor Lori, one day her and I are going to preach together. Do you remember when I sat at that restaurant and I was sharing with you some of the things? She's looking at me like, are you kidding me? I remember, I'll never forget, on Edinger and Red Hill, I sat with her and I began, and literally she didn't say anything, but she's thinking, Lord, what kind of friend did you bring me? But I said to her, I will never forget on that table. I said, one day, Pastor Laurie, my daughter and I are going to preach the word of God together. And do you know that I am preaching here? I took a sabbatical, or God spoke to me to stop preaching for a year, almost 2 years, a year and 8 months. This is the first time I've preached at a church on a Sunday for over a year and 8 months. Pastor Laurie knows because God had to do something to me. Don't get discouraged because you're not saying something. You know what?
God wants to see you grow in your faith. He wants you to begin to dig deep trenches. How do you dig deep wells? By spending time with the Lord. The Holy Spirit begins to, you know, do a work in you, and you're digging. So we need to dig deep trenches. You know why? Because when the enemy comes with his lies, he can't come and throw dirt on us. But we just get rid of that dirt. We just keep on getting rid of that dirt, and we don't give him any dirt to throw at us. How do we do that? By spending time with God. Amen. So faith recognizes that the impossible is possible. Faith declares. Faith believes. Faith is an act. It doesn't stand still. Stop standing still, Ignite Church. Stop standing still. It's time to get down and dirty, roll up your sleeves and say, come on, let's do this, Lord, because I'm ready to see some miracles, signs, and wonders follow me in Jesus' name. Follow this church. You know, this is the way that I minister to our church. I hope you guys are okay. Amen. You know, faith is a part of our character. That is so, so true. You know, when people see me, I believe God in Jesus' name. When they see me, they know that I'm a woman of faith. It's a part of my character. You know why I know that? And I really believe that because I have so many testimonies of what God does. And when the enemy comes knocking at my door, I just recall, like Jeremiah, oh God, what have you done? You know, okay, let's talk about when I was on welfare, had nothing to eat. But when I cried out in my kitchen, got on my knees, and I said, Lord, I'm not going to ask anybody for groceries, but I'm going to trust in you because you're faithful. You said you would provide my food and my water. So I trust you, Lord God, that the birds aren't going to eat better than me. Come on. I got on my knees. She's a little girl. I left it at the Lord in my kitchen floor. I left it, the prayer request there. I went off with my mom. I did not tell her. When I opened up my refrigerator that day, there was nothing there. So I left for the day. I come back, and there's a note on my door, and it's from my neighbor a couple of doors down from me in my apartment. And she says I was on housing, so that's why I had my own apartment. I was paying like $150 back in those days. But living on welfare. So if you do the math, I was barely getting by. And that was before the 900. I think at that time I was only getting like 600. Anyway, I was a tither. So I go get the note. I go to my neighbors, put our stuff in. Me and we're pregnant with our son, Jacob. Monique and I walk over to the neighbors, and she says, I left you a note because I had these bags. And she goes to the kitchen table, and there's bags there on her. She said, somebody left these bags on your front door, and I didn't want anyone to take them. It was peanut butter and jelly and tortillas and milk and eggs. I mean, I'm telling you, I had even laundry soap. Well, a woman gets in touch with me. Did you get the groceries? I said, you're the one that brought them. She said, yes. I was driving by Alpha Beta that back in the day, and she said, and the Spirit of the Lord said, go in there. And she said, for what? He says, go in there and I'll tell you. She did. He says, now go and buy this, and this. Okay, where am I taking it? Take it to Teresa's house. And she did. That morning, I stood before the Lord on my knees, and I cried out to God. And that same God that did that for me is the same God that will provide for me today. See, once you've encountered God, you know what he looks like. I know what he looks like as my provider because he's provided for me over and over and over again. Well, he doesn't look any different as my healer. And I just need to go into God and believe God through the word of God and confess the word of God. And then I'm going to begin to see what it looks like as my healer. I've already seen it. There's times that I'll have aches and pains because I'm getting older. And I begin to speak the word. I said, no, you have no right over my body. Devil, get off of me, you foul spirit. And I began to proclaim the word. You said you bless my food and my water, and you take sickness far from me. And I began to, now I know what he looks like as my healer. Do you get me? I mean, it's just us taking the word of God and applying it to our lives. And the last thing that I'm going to share with you is faith is the fuel that keeps us going. You know, if you feel like you're in a place that's dead, or that you don't have your, you know, you're down, you're discouraged, you know, it's because you're not walking by faith. And one thing that I've learned, when I've not walked in faith, I have recognized how dead I feel in the inside, because there's no purpose inside me. And when we give God something to, you know, when we're okay, Lord, I'm going to believe God. When we begin to walk by faith, then he begins to download fuel. He begins to energize us. It's not the opposite. if I don't believe, I don't have to work so hard. No, if you believe that you're going to get this Holy Spirit, you know, this kind of power that's going to come, and you're going to be able to glorify God. You know, I'm a faith keeper. Therese Alvarado is a faith. I hold on to faith. There's a scripture in Hebrews 10:23. It says, let us hold unwavering to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. Just know that he who promised you is faithful. What he said he was going to do in your life, he will do it. Amen. Thank you. We'll be right back.